I would love to discuss that, because every single time I hear someone talk about self-defense, I just have to laugh, because don't get me wrong, like, it, first off, what is self-defense? It's this giant, nebulous, non-specific scenario where, I remember when I started MMA, people, someone would say, man, I think one of, maybe I can't remember where I read it or something, oh, if he fights a guy that's like, you know, a D1 All-American with like, you know, like Golden Gloves, champion level boxing and like a blue belt in Jiu-jitsu, he's gonna have a hard time. I'm like, yeah, no shit, idiot. You know, like, fuck, if I have a gun, that guy's gonna have a hard time. We're gonna create a scenario. I can create a fighter that can beat any other fighter if I get to think about the skills that this person needs to have. So what's interesting is, in self-defense situations, obviously the most important thing any of us has, and the only reason that we're here on this planet, living in nice places that are warm instead of cold, or cool instead of direly hot, is because we have a brain, and we use this to figure out the best thing to do in different scenarios. And, you know, there is no magic solution for anything. But when I hear people talk about self-defense a lot, I think, oh, let's practice the hip toss, or like, okay, the guy grabs me like this, and I've never in a million years seen something like that actually exist in real life. And I don't hang out outside of shitty bars all the time, but sometimes I do, and I've seen these things, I'm like, it never goes down that way. I would, having competed at the highest level in Jiu-Jitsu, having trained with some of the best MMA fighters in the world and working hard to try to be like them, and having trained against like Olympic level judo players, I know what it's like to go like this on someone in judo, but instead of standing perfectly, I was just this much, and then my feet hit the ceiling. Because this guy is at such a high level of understanding your balance that God help you if you grab him the wrong way. That man will throw you on your head. He got that way by training like a real martial artist, like someone in MMA, like someone in a jiu-jitsu class, like someone in wrestling. He didn't get that way by practicing the hip toss on someone that's doing this, or practicing double legs on someone that's gonna run at you like a goofball. I think that for the most part, obviously self-defense is different than MMA, but it's for psychological reasons, and it's for tactical reasons, where I have to assume that the other guy has friends, that the other guy might be armed. But again, that's like when you go on the internet, if you were to waste your time on an internet forum, oh man, this guy was an Olympic wrestler, but he got stabbed 15 times. I'm like, I got an idea. You give a pocket knife to your 10-year-old cousin, you tell him to kill you, and you try to take it away from him. Good luck. You'll get the knife away from the kid, but you're gonna get cut up too. And it's, you may get the knife away from the kid, maybe you get killed. But the idea is, there's, real life is imperfect. And a lot of times the narrative and the discussion for self-defense situations happens in a vacuum, in a box, where I get to discuss what happened from my armchair, not being involved. So I guess I would say that when I think about self-defense, I think that the most important qualities that someone can have are, you know, an ability to look at a situation and read it. And then if they're in shape, if they're strong, if they're used to fighting, if they have skill with their hands or skill with wrestling or something else, nothing is guaranteed, but you have an incredible advantage over any normal person. And I guess that's kind of that.
What do you think will be the next big thing in Jiu-Jitsu?
Wow, I feel hesitant to comment, honestly, because I've been out of the Gi Jiu-Jitsu scene for a little while. So someone put me in the worm guard the other day. And I remember going like, what in the heck is this? What? Get off of my leg, man. Like, trying to figure out how to move. And I think that there's always going to be so much room for innovation with weird little things in the grip game and whatnot. But honestly, I think that rather than speculate as to which techniques I think will help, I would say that the rule set is going to determine which techniques happen. So people complain, oh, jiu-jitsu guys a lot of times can't wrestle. Like, I can wrestle pretty well. I don't wrestle like a great wrestler, obviously, because I'm not a great wrestler. But I can wrestle pretty well. Gunny wrestles very well. There's certain jiu-jitsu guys that wrestle very well, sometimes because they wrestled as a child or later on in life, other times because they decided to learn. But they became that way in spite of the rules, because the rules don't encourage you to wrestle. If you go to ADCC, you have to learn how to wrestle if you want to do well, but or it helps. But in Gi Jiu-Jitsu, even in no-Gi Jiu-Jitsu with the IBJJF rules, for the most part you can get away without wrestling because the rules let you. Knee reaping, I don't even know what that is. That's this crazy, scary sounding thing that doesn't exist. But you put it in people's mind. I remember, I've seen it happen once or twice in my academy, where white belt A freaks out at white belt B. You reap my knee! And then the other guy goes, what are you talking about? And I'm watching all this happen from the corner, and the guy's like, man, you gotta be careful. And I walk over, I'm like, hey guys, can I help? He reaped my knee. Oh, that's terrible. Can I try something? And I go, whap, and I throw my leg over. He's like, oh, my leg is fine. I'm like, yeah, it doesn't do anything. It's like a kimura on your leg, man. You're okay, you're fine. But if you put it in their head, they start to fear it. And it's funny, if you never said something like this to someone, it would just become part of what they do. People think of wrestling as separate from jiu-jitsu because early on in our time in jiu-jitsu, it's taught as this different thing, this separate thing. We hear about wrestlers or something like that. It's nonsense. If you think about wrestling, they learn top position. This is something Furasahabi was talking with me about, and I agree with him completely. You hear about top position, bottom position, you know, like all sorts of things. There's Greco, but yeah, there's upper body wrestling, lower body wrestling, but unless you're going to change the sport, it's just wrestling. There's not someone's like, oh yeah, today we're going to do wrestling on the bottom, but no wrestling on the feet. Today we're going to do wrestling on the feet, but nothing on the ground. You do the whole sport every day. And it's like saying, only guard today, and if you sweep someone, we're going to stop. Yeah, usually, but there's always got to be a guard passer. So basically, I think that the rules are going to dictate which direction we go, and if we'd like to generate certain types of techniques, like if I want to create great leg lockers that I think are very, very dangerous in MMA and very, very dangerous in no-gi, I have to take away the knee-reaping rule because I'm crippling people's understanding of how the legs work. If I want to make sure that people learn how to do judo and learn how to take someone down, I need to stop letting them pull guard right in the beginning, or I need to penalize that. Because if I shoot on you, even if I get 2 points, sometimes in the beginning it's not worth the effort, man. If I'm a white belt, you're a white belt, I'm like, man, I don't know how to do this. That was me in the beginning. I did not wrestle. I was like, you know what, I'm just going to sit down. If the other guy didn't have to come to the floor, I mean, thank goodness that was the rule because I wouldn't have learned certain things, which I feel fortunate again, so the rules allowed me to do that. But I would have been a much better wrestler much earlier on if when I sat down, the other guy looked at me like this and went, I have to get up. I guarantee you, inside of 3 months, I would have had, I wouldn't be great, but I would have one takedown at least that would be kind of like, yeah, that's my thing, I feel comfortable, as opposed to going for 4 years before learning how to take someone down. So I think that we need to think about the rules, and then the techniques will happen on their own.
You worked a lot on deep half guard stuff, and something which has been very popular of late, last year, but seems to be kind of less popular now.
Mm-hmm.
What do you see the future of regarding the deep half guard?
I think it's going to go in cycles. I think it's going to become increasingly popular. There was a time when 50-50 was everything, and then a little less now. I'm sure people probably still do it, but Barambolo, everyone loves Barambolo right now. Man, in 5 years, no one's going to like Barambolo because everyone's going to know how to do it, and everyone's going to have seen so much of it that, oh man, oh that, yeah, of course it still works, but everyone uses it, so everyone knows how to defend it. Oh man, but check out this new half guard position I do. It's not new. The same way the Barambolo is not new, the 50-50 is not new, but it's new to me, or new to the next generation of guy. So it becomes, just like everything else, or most things in life, like a cycle. I think that the half guard is going to come back into popularity because no one has solved the half guard. No one has solved the Barambolo. No one has solved the close guard. That's like saying, oh, I know how to stop the double leg. Yeah, okay, great. And then when I stop the double leg, he goes to the single, or he goes to the high crotch or something. And then when I defend that, he goes back to the double leg. So the key was being able to mix everything together. I think one of the interesting things actually about the cycles is that spider guard never became popular. Man, you have Michael Lange, you have Cabrinha, you have Romulo Bajal, you got a couple other guys that are really phenomenal with the spider guard, but it's just off to the side enough that it never stopped being really effective because only a few people do it. Which is always interesting because half guard was very popular. There's at least in the United States, there's Jeff Glover, there's me, there's a couple other people. Jake McKenzie has one of the best half guards in the world. He's in Brazil competing for GF team right now. I think he thinks half guard works. He chokes a lot of people from the back. I see videos. I try to keep up on him because he's my friend. That's another thing. I think deep half guard works in MMA, and I'm willing to show it, and at the very least risk getting punched in the face to show it. But it'll be interesting. I can't wait to see, you know, something else like close guard become popular again, and then see the new thing. Because usually it's just one little change that opens up the position again. So it'll be pretty cool when that happens.
Thank you for the time.
Thank you so much.